As I was preparing for the sermon this week and reading scripture to kind of bring focus to what I wanted to say in this season of Lent, there was a passage that kind of just leaped out to me, and sometimes that's the way of it. I'll read scripture, and then all of a sudden there will be this one passage of scripture that just really says, this is the word that needs to be spoken. And as I began to think on the passage and all that it meant, I began to look across the church, especially the American church, and I began to see, you know, today we're in this real precarious position. The American church is, you know, kind of on shaky ground. Statistics are showing us that American churches are in decline, that we are seeing a constant decrease in the number of people, the number of money, the number of resources that are available to us. The Oklahoma Conference released the numbers for apportionments in 2016, and we received $1.6 million less to operate the annual conference this last year. That puts us below 90% of giving across churches, and that is, I think, in my immediate recollection, that's the lowest that I can call to mind that we've received. We know that worship attendance declining. We know that membership is declining. We know that people making declarations of faith is declining. We see these numbers going down farther and farther and farther. In the midst of that, we have a lot of people within the American church who believe that culture is closing ports of entry that the church has had in the past into influencing culture. That culture seems to be turning its back on the message and the offering of what the church has. There are some who believe that the churches of America are the moral center that have to fight back in this war against culture and the cultural shifts that are happening around us, that they have to make a stand against things that are changing around them. And all of this is happening within a context of fewer people within congregations who read and understand the Bible and yet use it more and more to defend things that are not of first importance, of primary importance. Congregations, particularly congregations in the U.S., do not stress the things of first importance anymore. We have kind of taken on the task of dealing with things that fall down the priority tree. We don't talk about the things that Scripture tells us are the single most important thing about our identity as followers of Christ. Like, what was Jesus about in his life, in his example, in his death and resurrection? What did he represent to people? What truly brings us into connection with the creating God who loves us even in our sin? What is it that our individual witness is about, and how does that play a role in what we do in a daily basis to transform the world for the kingdom? We've walked away, we've turned away from these things of first importance for things that are of lower priority. And this is what Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. Now I remind you, brothers and sisters, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. If you will hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though that was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preached, and so you believed. Will you join me in a spirit of prayer? God, we are the recipients in a long legacy of gospel preaching. All of us represent the communication of the good news of what saved those early apostles. We are their descendants, carrying on that which was so valuable to them. A message for the forgiveness of sins and a life that is abundant and everlasting. We live in this legacy. But it is not ours to treasure. It is ours to bestow upon others. It is ours to give away, for in the giving away, the kingdom is enriched. Your name is multiplied, and your grace is given so many more opportunities to be poured out into the world. So help us, Almighty God, to live into the legacy that we have received. Allow us to meditate, to focus, to bring forth the message of that which is of first importance, but may we also declare it and share it and witness to it within the world. In this message, may my words be yours, that I would speak wisdom and truth according to your will and your word. May our hearts and minds be shaped by the message of the Holy Spirit that speaks into us, that by means of those words we live to you. Greater and greater each and every day. I pray these things in your name, Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. Okay. So the food pantry is definitely seeing effects from the climate that the culture is in. When I read these passages of Scripture from 1 Corinthians, there were a couple things that, you know, kind of leaped forward that I want to ask you to keep in mind. The first thing is this. Paul is writing to believers. He's writing to a church who is already established. They've already heard the preaching. They have already had the benefit of believing in that preaching. And there's evidence to say that they have also experienced the Holy Spirit's outpouring. That there are gifts manifesting the presence of the Holy Spirit within the life of the church. Paul is writing to what we, by every definition, would call Christians, who are actively involved in a church. But notice what he says to them. First, he reminds them of the gospel that they had heard. He reminds them, this is the message that you took away. This is the message that I brought to you, and this is the message that has changed your life. This message of who Jesus Christ is and what Jesus Christ accomplished, these things are what you have heard and received. And now, you can choose to stand fast in them. He's reminding them of what the gospel content was that they received. But then he encourages them, you need to stand fast. You need to not be moved in this. The thing that you've received, that is supposed to reinforce your life. It is supposed to keep you from not falling back into what you have been. Stand fast in this and do not give up on the gospel that you have heard, and then stresses that these are the things which are of first importance. This gospel that they heard, that Jesus has died for our sins, that Jesus was buried and raised, and that Jesus appeared after that death and that resurrection to many of the faith, these are things of first importance. These are the things that made the difference in the church. And these are the things that will continue to make the greatest difference in the life of the church going forward. Paul is stressing that the thing that made you who you are is the thing that should continue to shape who you will be. Second thing to keep in mind is this. Paul is also writing to believers in a church who have a lot of sin that still disrupts their life. If you read through 1 Corinthians, you see that these are people who, even in spite of their faith, they have ways of breaking community with one another. In spite of the belief that they have in a God who takes away from their sin, they continue to allow sin within themselves to continue to corrupt and disrupt the lives that they experience individually and corporately. Sin is still infecting the members of the community. It's still infecting the community as a whole. It still transforms and changes everything that they want to accomplish. It still draws away from the life that Christ has brought to them. God has already shown them something that can be done about this sin. God has already said, look, my love I've revealed to you. I've revealed it to you in my Son. My Son has offered you a way out of this sin. God has offered us a way to fix the sickness. God has offered us a way to be changed from that sin. As long as sin remains within the body of Christ, those things of first importance still need to be stressed. Because as long as sin remains within the body of Christ, as long as it still infects the community and the individual, there is still the necessity to hear the message, Jesus Christ died for your sins, Jesus was buried and was raised, and Jesus rose up from that and ascended to heaven. There is a necessity to hear these things of first importance. But when we survey the surface of the church today, we see that these things of first importance are not declared nearly as much anymore. We see things of secondary importance that come to the forefront. We have to reorient ourselves to these things of first importance. These need to occupy us. They need to fill what it is that we do with one another and in the world. It is what we have to be about. It is what defines us. It is what shapes us. It is what changes us from the very beginning. All of us heard the gospel. All of us heard Jesus died for our sins. Jesus has given us something to live for. That's our message of primary importance. It is the thing that we need to orient ourselves to. But it is not enough just to say the cross is all we need. That is important. It is a part of what is going on. But there are things that must come before and after the cross that we need to stress, that must be a part of what we talk about. The first one is that Jesus must be God. Jesus must be God. Because when we talk about sin in our lives, when we talk about the thing which separates us from God, we have to stop and recognize there is not anything anyone can do to take us out of that sin except God. Because everyone else is just as messed up as we are. When we are in sin, when we are trapped in what sin is doing in our lives, it's like we are stuck in a mud puddle that is just slimy and slippery, and it sticks to us. And even if we have a rope right there, every time we grab hold of it, we are so covered in that slime that we cannot get a grip and pull ourselves out. We need someone who can take us out of that, and that can only be God. If we talk about Jesus going to the cross to die for our sins, then we must declare that Jesus was God in the beginning. Jesus was God in his life. He was God on the cross. He was God after the resurrection, and he is still God today. We have to say that. We have to declare that, because any other way of trying to remove sin is impossible. Only God can take us out of sin. Secondly, Jesus has to be incarnated. Now, that's a big fancy theological word to say Jesus had to be one of us. Jesus had to come down and become flesh and blood. And this is one of the great mysteries of theology, one of the great misunderstandings of approaching Jesus. Jesus was fully human being. He came into the world. He was flesh and blood. He was just as limited as we were by the body. But he was also fully God. Some great mysterious way, Jesus brings together both of the natures that he had in this balance, so that when he is in this world experiencing humanity with us, he is also experiencing it not just as a human being, but also as God. He is going through this experience, and he is seeing what we go through. He's experiencing the things that we go through so that he can accomplish what must be done to take us out of sin. He has to be able to experience us so that we can approach him, so that we can come to him and say, "You understand what I'm going through. You understand what limit I have." He has to be fully God, but he also has to be fully human. Next, Jesus must live a life that exemplifies what is possible and what is necessary. There's a lot of belief that centers around, you know what, there's only one perfect person, and that's Jesus, and I will never be like him. That's not right. Jesus walked in this world to show us what was possible. He said it himself, "You need to be perfect as your Father is perfect." Now, would Jesus lie to us and tell us to do something that was impossible? Would he set before us a standard and then under his breath mutter, "But you'll never get there"? Would he go about showing his disciples how to live the life that he expected them to live and hold before them this standard, "You will perfect yourself in love"? Knowing that they would never accomplish that? No. Jesus lived a life that exemplified what was possible, but he also exemplified a life that is necessary. He exemplified a life that we have to live into to truly grasp what it is that God is about, to truly grasp what it is that God can do in and through and around our lives. Have y'all noticed me say that a lot? In and through and around? Or is that one of those things that y'all sweep into the corner of sleep during the sermon? I say it a lot because it represents the nature of the work that Jesus Christ brings into our life. He does something in us, but then he does something through us so that he accomplishes something around us. If we cannot do what is necessary, nothing will get accomplished around us. Because nothing will be accomplished through us, that means nothing is accomplished within us. We live after his example, a life that is possible and necessary. Jesus then dies to make atonement possible for us. He dies to make it possible to see the wrong righted, to see that which separates us from God removed, to take and bring us into a communion, into a fellowship. He makes it possible that we can have this relationship with God. I'm going to talk more about atonement next week and what it represented in the Old Testament, what it represented in Jesus Christ, what it means for us today. But the cross is the first step in understanding what Jesus makes possible. When he dies, there is something that happens in that act that over the span of history and time and his life now begins the process by which we can be made right with God. Jesus then dies to make atonement. He is then raised to make atonement real, to basically declare, hey, this works. God bless Billy Mays. Y'all remember who Billy Mays was? Do you remember the OxyClean commercials? The little short guy with the black hair and the beard? That was Billy Mays. He made you believe that OxyClean worked, such that it is still a part of the product offering that you can see in the grocery stores. In fact, he made people believe that it worked so well that they now use OxyClean and other products to say that it works better. Jesus being raised from the dead is his Billy Mays moment in saying, look, what I did on the cross, it's real. It works. It can make a difference. It can change. It can transform. It can do something. Because by God, if I can walk out of a tomb, then your life can be better. Stop and think about that for just a minute. God raised Jesus from the dead, which most of us thought was impossible to be cured, and then says, now come to me to have your sins forgiven. My resurrection proves this works. It does work in your life. It will work in your life. Jesus is raised to make atonement real. Then he ascends to heaven to make it applicable, to make it relevant to our lives. Because now he goes out and he sets a goal out in front of us. He says, look, if you can come into this relationship, if you can accept this, if you can take this upon yourself and have your life transformed, there's something out there that you're going to achieve because of it. There's something that it will become a result of what you're doing right now. If you can have your life made better, if you can come into that right relationship with God, if you can accept what I've done for you, I promise you, there is something out there that is going to be accomplished because of that. He has to go to heaven to prepare that so that he can come back and claim us, so that he can come and take us into that reward. But that's not the end of what's of first importance. It's also this. Grace has to assist us to believe in faith on who Jesus is and what Jesus' life and death and resurrection and ascension are about. Grace has to come to us and make it possible for us to believe in that which is impossible. It is impossible to believe that a human being was God. It is impossible for us to believe that a person can be perfected in love. It is impossible for us to hold on to the idea that he would die not just for a few people or not just for the people that he liked, but that he died for everybody in all time throughout the past, present, and future in all realms of the world. It is impossible for us to believe that somebody can die and get better. It is impossible to believe that a human being could walk up into the clouds and disappear to go into the heavens and sit at the right hand of God. It is impossible to believe all of that. But grace comes and brings faith so that it now becomes possible to know these things, to hold these things, to stand fast in these things. We have to have grace come to us and make that possible, which is truly impossible to believe. These are the things of first importance. These are the things that are the message of the church. If we do not believe these things, then there is no transformation. If we do not believe these things, we are not changed. If we don't hold on to the full measure of what Jesus Christ was and was about, then we really have nothing that has made us different. Which is why Paul says, look, if you hold fast to this word that I preached you, or you believed in vain, you hold fast to all of that which I proclaimed to you, or there's really nothing that can be done for you. We have to believe this. If we don't proclaim this, there is no hope or joy in the life of the church. If we do not proclaim these things of first importance, then we have nothing to be joy-filled about. There is nothing that we can hope about. Did you notice all of the songs this morning? I've told y'all before that I usually do my songs based on the sermon. Ask this great thing that I know. Who is it that made a difference in my life? It is Jesus Christ, the crucified. Oh, how I love Jesus because he first loved me. Glory to his name. For when I went to him at the cross, at that fountain, he saved me. When we do not proclaim these things, we have nothing to be joyful about. When we do not proclaim these things, we have no hope to offer the world. If we do not witness to this, there is no growth in the kingdom. If we're not telling people about these things of first importance, the church does not grow. The church will not grow when we are being the moral center of the universe. The church will not grow when we are the social instruments of society. The church grows when we let people know that there is someone in the history of this world who made a difference in every life, and we have latched onto that person and we experience the change that he offers, but it is not just for us, it is for all. That's when the church grows. That's when the church sees its continuing expansion. If we do not share this, if we do not go out into the world and tell the world about it, then the world will continue to close its doors to the church. It will continue to turn a deaf ear to what we have to say, and the culture will continue to change around us. We cannot fight change by saying, well, that's just wrong. It doesn't work. It didn't work for any of us when our parents said that when we were teenagers, did it? You tell us what's wrong, or you tell us what not to do, what is the first thing we're going to do when they turn their back? We're going to find the fastest way into the thing we're not supposed to do. Well, it doesn't work. Telling the world, you shouldn't do that because it's not the right thing to do. But when we tell the world, you know what? I believe in this guy called Jesus. He was God. But he loved us so much that he gave up everything to come and live a limited experience, to come and be like you and me, to experience everything that we experience, all the heartache, all the pain, all of the suffering. He came and experienced that. And then he tried to live better than that. He tried to live above his circumstances. He tried to live above the limitation that the world tried to put upon him. But then he died. But he died for purpose. He died so that sin could be removed from between us and God, so that we might be able to live into a new kind of relationship. And then God raised him up from the dead to prove that it was possible, to prove that if God could change that impossible, that one thing that we all say there's no coming back from, if God could change that, then God can obviously change a life. And then he ascended into heaven, and he claimed an authority, and he said, if you can hold on to me even in your inability to see me, I promise you there's going to be an end to that. There's going to be a result of that. There's going to be a reward for that. If we can proclaim that, if we can be the witnesses to that, if we share that in the world, that's when the church will flourish. That's when the statistics won't matter anymore. That's when culture cannot turn a deaf ear to us. That is when we start showing others that love makes a difference in how we behave. if we believe, if we proclaim, if we witness, and if we share, the church will flourish even in the midst of adversity and persecution. Because that's always when it is flourishing.